In this video, I'm going to talk about capacitors and inductors. A capacitor is a very simple circuit element. At its heart, all it is two wires and two plates. If I were to attach the capacitor to a voltage source, then no current would actually flow in steady state because there's a gap between these two plates. Now, what happens if there is a voltage V on a voltage source? Then that voltage is going to show up across the two plates of a capacitor. There will be charge accumulating on one of the two plates, and of course one of the two plates will be positive compared to the other one. Now the question is, how many charges are there on the plates? This is going to depend on the distance between the plates, because if the plates are closer together, then the attraction can be stronger. If the plates are further apart, then the charge difference is not so visible to the electrons. Normally, we use the symbol Q to represent charge. The amount of charge on the plate of a capacitor is going to be related to the voltage applied. More voltage, more charge, but it's also related to the value of a capacitance. The SI unit for capacitance is the farad. So farad times voltage equals coulomb, and coulomb is the SI unit for charge. If you have a higher capacitance value, then your capacitor can store more charges at a given voltage. Charge is very interesting because in a capacitor, it's related to the surface area. If you have a bigger surface area, then it would be able to hold more charges. So let me write down what capacitance is and how it relates to the surface area. So capacitance C is related to epsilon A over D, and A is the surface area of the plate, and D is the distance between the plates. Epsilon is the dielectric constant, so if you change the material between the plate, then it can cause the attraction of the charges to be either stronger or weaker, depending on what that material is. The reason I've drawn this is to point out that the capacitance is related to the surface area, because more surface area, more charge. But it's also useful to see what happens if we have more than one capacitor wired up in parallel. I'm going to add another capacitor to the circuit diagram. We haven't changed the voltage source, so we still have the same voltage applied across the second capacitor. The question is now, how much charge is stored in total? Well, if the two capacitors are the same and the two surface areas are now the same, then we've got double the charge as before. So if I want to add capacitors in parallel, I could equivalently say that these two capacitors in parallel are equal to a single capacitor that had a value twice the capacitance of those in the previous diagram. So capacitors in parallel add. This is unlike the situation in resistors or inductors. But going back to this equation that relates charge to voltage, I can now start to think about what happens if I change the amount of charge. And a change in the charge is current. The reason why a change in charge is related to the current is because if you want to move charges onto the plate of a capacitor, or you want to remove the charges from the plate of a capacitor, then current has to flow at least for a short time. So I can write that current I equals the time derivative of the charge. And continuing on from the equation, I have the time derivative of CV, and a capacitance value is constant. So I equals C dV over dt. And this equation will be useful later when we start looking at RC time constants. Now let's move on now to inductors. An inductor is basically just a coil of wire. And when you were a child, if you ever coiled up a piece of wire around a nail or anything that's ferromagnetic, you would have realized that you can very easily make an electromagnet if you hook the wires up to a battery. And the reason for that is that anytime you have current flowing, you create a magnetic field. The appropriate word to use to talk about the magnetic field that's created in an inductor is the word flux. Flux refers, for example, to magnetic field lines that appear encircling a wire, and the flux lines in an inductor run through it. This shows up as a magnetic field. When you hook the inductor up to a battery, you create magnetic flux, and you experience that as a magnetic field. Now, that happens in an inductor too, even if there's no ferromagnetic in the middle. If you just make a coil around air, you'll still get a magnetic field. It's just that the magnetic field won't be as strong as it would be if you used a metal, for example, that's iron, something ferromagnetic as the core. The symbol that we like to use for flux is a capital phi. If you have more current flowing through an inductor, then there will be more flux lines. So I can write a simple equation that flux equals L times I. So I is the current, more flux. And also, depending on the geometry of your inductor or whether you've used an iron core or an air core, then you could also have a different amount of flux. So this comes into play with the inductance, or L. If you have a larger inductor with, for example, more turns or a different sort of a core material, then you would have more flux. Or if you just simply pass more current through the wire, then you would also have more flux. Voltage is related to the change in flux. So I can write that V is the time derivative of this magnetic flux. And since the inductance L depends only on the geometry of the inductor, then I can pull it out of the derivative and write V equals L dI over dt. And this equation will be useful later because it describes the current and voltage relationship in an inductor. If you enjoyed watching this video, then you might be interested in following our playlist and learning more about the fundamentals of electrical circuits.